kidnapping, extortion, and murder.
This case was in a league of its own.
The panorama of tawdriness unmatched in Miami's rather tawdry history.
Bodybuilders running amok in paradise.
They duct taped his eyes.
What began as an extortion plot ended up in murder.
Pistol whipping him across the face. Boom, they hit him with a car.
What they lacked in morals, they made up for in greed.
A brazen, twisted scheme so strange, police refused to believe it even happened. Until it happened again.
My worst nightmare looks like it's come true. The gang has struck again.
It reads like Pulp Fiction. Businessmen dripping in new money. Bad guys all hopped up on greed and steroids. An incredibly diabolical plot. And a telltale breast implant. And where would a story like this be set? Miami, anyone?
Miami is a place of sun and sand and sex. Gyms are everywhere. Pumping up and being beautiful and being able to show off your physique is part of the way of life here.
There is huge conspicuous consumption here. It's a boom town, and there are lots of sources, both legal and illegal, for that kind of boom town atmosphere.
It's a place that people who have wealth are attracted to, and it's a place where people who want wealth are attracted to. And I think in this case, the two of those factors came together in a violent way.
No one personified nouveau riche Miami more than Hungarian millionaire Frank Griga. He was just a car salesman when he arrived in Florida, but a few short years in paradise later, he was a self-made millionaire.
Frank must have been about 25, 26 when he really started to make money. And first he was like a kid in a toy store. I remember when he first bought his Lamborghini. He chose the color, and then when he picked it up, he was so happy. He was, probably that was the happiest in his life, when he picked that car up. If there was anyone making the American dream happen, I think Frank was one. He really wanted to have a slice of it, and he did.
Right about the time that Griga came to this country and started working in businesses, 976 numbers were an enormous profit center, and he was smart enough to cash in on that.
He realized that you could actually provide a little bit more than information. You could provide entertainment. He had about 40 or 50 such lines. Nine Romance was a major one, I know. 976 Tits, which was kind of more sexually explicit.
Griga was making millions from pay-per-minute phone lines, and he and his live-in girlfriend, Christina Furton, were living the high life. There was a Miami Vice mansion on the water, a private yacht, and a stable full of luxury cars to keep the Lamborghini company. But trouble was lurking in Griga's rearview mirror, and he never saw it coming.
It was Memorial Day weekend, and they were supposed to go to the Bahamas. The next day, the housekeeper came. She saw the dog there, and that was weird. The dog wasn't supposed to be there. Frank would never leave the dog there unattended. That was the first sign that something bad is happening to them. She actually saw Frank's passport was lying on his desk, and that was a sign they never went to the Bahamas in the first place, because, you know, you need a passport to go to the Bahamas. It was very much out of character for him to be missing. We always knew where he was.
So their friends contact the police, and they basically tell them everything. You know, we have a couple of friends, and they're very conscientious. They would never leave their dog at home alone, and they just disappeared off the face of the earth. So the police start to ask questions. And one of the questions they ask is, who were they last seen with?
The very last phone conversation I had with Frank was on the day of his disappearance. He was approached by two businessmen. They were offering him some kind of potential cable business in India. These two guys were big, they were bodybuilders, they were very showy, expensive suits, expensive watches. Gaudy is the word, I think.
Muscle-bound dudes in Armani flashing a little bling? Well, that only describes like half the population of Miami. But there was something about these two that set Griga on edge.
Frank really had a very weird feeling about these two people. And he said, well, I'm going to give it one more shot. I'm going to go out to dinner with them and we'll, you know, I will listen to what they want to say one more time. And that was the last time I spoke to him.
At this point, all police had to go on was a housekeeper telling them that these people were missing and some other person who was able to tell police that they had seen the couple going out to dinner with a couple of guys who looked like bodybuilders.
The police department simply treated him as another person who is young, who is wealthy, who likes to run around, who likes to travel, and they didn't take it seriously.
Then they found the Lamborghini. Very expensive car, abandoned, wealthy couple missing, and that's when the police really began to dig into this case and worry about the possibility of foul play.
Cops try to get a lead on the two men who met with the couple before they disappeared.
The names Lugo and Dorball come up, and all of a sudden it's like a light switch comes on.
Daniel Lugo and Adrian Dorball, co-workers at a joint called the Sun Gym, were suspects in another rich guy kidnapping plot already under investigation.
Sun Gym was a magnet for all kinds of bad guys. I felt that these guys were the baddest people I had ever come in contact with. So now it's happened. My worst nightmare, it looks like it's come true. The gang has struck again.
Who are these bodybuilders? And what have they done with Griga and Furton? And why are the police so familiar with the Sun Gym? While investigating the missing Miami phone sex millionaire and his girlfriend, police stumble onto another investigation involving the same pumped-up bad guys. Delving into this earlier case would lead police into a depraved world of greed and violence unlike anything they'd ever seen before. It all started at a testosterone factory called the Sun Gym.
Sun Gym was a gym out in Miami Lakes that was started by John Meese, a CPA, who was also a frustrated bodybuilder. Sun Gym was a place that they wanted to be massive, a different kind of clientele.
There are other people who were apparently taking steroids and using that to build up their muscles. So it was, it was something of a musclehead kind of gym.
Gym owner John Meese may have been a prominent accountant, but this venture was hemorrhaging hard. Meese was desperate for someone to save his house of pain. Then along came Daniel Lugo.
Daniel Lugo seemed to have been a pretty persuasive guy with John Meese, filling him full of ideas of grandeur about the marketing possibilities of the Sun Gym brand and how they could expand and get into various kinds of food products or clothing, that sort of thing.
Lugo promised Meese they'd build an empire from the ashes. He was so convincing that Meese hired him on as manager. But Lugo had a past. He had just finished a stint in federal prison for fraud.
Daniel Lugo used the Sun Gym as a big networking opportunity. He was always looking for a way to grab a quick buck. And he was identifying people as either possible cohorts in this kind of activity or targets. Daniel Lugo certainly seems to have had something magnetic about him because an awful lot of people were willing to do an awful lot of terrible things on his behalf.
And that was the beauty of the Sun Gym. Whatever scheme Lugo cooked up, all he had to do was step into the weight room to find some hulking freak to help him get the job done. He found the perfect disciple in Adrian Noel Dorball.
Dorball, at first sight, was the one you said, oh yeah, that guy's a bodybuilder. He was massively muscled, had long dark hair. It certainly seems that Adrian Dorball had a big attachment to Daniel Lugo. They seem very quintessentially Miami muscle guys. They build their bodies to be out and about and seen. They were enamored of a lot of the trappings of the fast Miami lifestyle.
But that kind of flashy lifestyle requires deep pockets, and their measly paychecks just weren't cutting it.
When George Delgado walked through the Sun Gym doors, it certainly seems like Daniel Lugo quickly identified him as somebody who was around money and who might be a partner in some of his fast buck ideas.
So when Delgado wants a personal trainer, Lugo gets the job. And one day, in between sets, Delgado starts complaining about a fat cat entrepreneur named Marcelo Schiller.
Mark Schiller was a businessman from Argentina who ran a sort of investment and insurance kind of company. Schiller had a lot of money. He had a multi-million dollar estate, houses, money, cars.
Delgado was all pissed off because he bought some sort of Medicare billing business from Schiller and he felt that he'd overpaid.
Delgado increasingly, particularly after he met Daniel Lugo, became convinced that he was getting the short end of the financial stick from Mark Schiller, and Mark Schiller then becomes their target.
Delgado, Lugo, and Dorball cooked up a get-rich-quick scheme that couldn't fail. They'd kidnap Schiller, torture him, and force him to sign over all his assets.
They had several plans. One of the plans called for them to lay in his front yard underneath camouflage blankets, and as he came out to get his paper in the morning, they would jump up and say, "Aha, we got you," and they'd grab him and throw him into a van. It's a pretty silly scheme.
It took them several iterations of their plot, because little things kept going wrong, and they seemed to be fairly easily spooked by those little things that weren't going just according to the book.
Lugo had enlisted several other pumped-up punks from the Sun Gym to help nab Schiller, but each time they tried, their cartoonish plans failed. Frustrated, Lugo and Dorball added some more muscle, but this guy would be kept in the dark about their real plans.
I had just walked into the gym, and Noel, he tells me, "Listen, you know, there is this scumbag drug dealer that owes me a lot of money, and I was wondering if you could help me collect from him." I specifically told him, "I'm not gonna do anything illegal. I'm not gonna beat up anybody for you. So under those conditions, if you just want me to intimidate so this guy can pay you, then I'll do that, you know." I got in the van with Noel Dorbal, and we were off.
On November 15th of 94, they set up outside of Mark Schiller's deli in far west Miami-Dade. It's not a heavily traveled area, but at 4 in the afternoon, they saw their chance. There was nobody else around.
I remember the day so clearly. It was an overcast day. The guy gets out of his restaurant. I believe he's wearing jeans and a white polo shirt. It was seconds afterwards that I came to the realization that this was not what was told it was. They grabbed the guy and they started tasing him. And the guy is hanging on to the steering wheel of his 4Runner, hanging off for dear life. And I said, "Oh my God, what is this?" They dragged the guy to the door of the van, and I'm petrified. Noel yells at me, "Grab him, grab him."
Go, 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 go.
I got scared, and I did. I grabbed him. They duct taped his eyes and they duct taped his wrist. We took off and Noel keeps trying to call this number. He said, "The Eagle has landed. The Eagle has landed."
The Sun Gym gang had finally nabbed Marcelo Schiller, but they'd have to go to great lengths to squeeze his money out of him and even greater lengths to kill him. The Sun Gym gang had finally accomplished their first audacious crime, abducting wealthy businessman Marcelo Schiller. Now all they had to do was separate the millionaire from his money, and that would get very, very messy.
When we pulled up to the warehouse, I realized that this warehouse was where the Sun Gym kept their equipment. All of a sudden, all these people are crawling out of the woodwork. This is not a small operation. There's this guy, Delgado, Danny, Lugo was there. All of a sudden, this turned into something that was, like, planned. It felt really eerie because I see that the guy was in a box. It just felt cold. It was obvious to me that it was much more than what I had bargained for. All that's going through my head is like, how the hell am I gonna get out of this? You know, if these guys are willing to do this, to collect this money, I mean, what would they do to me if they feel that I'm not cool with what they're doing? I was scared because I know that Noel knows how my kid looks like. He knows where he goes to school. And I told Noel, "Get me out of here now. I want you to take me home, man. I did what I was supposed to do. I want to go home. And I did.
The gang would spend the next month implementing their cruel plan. Step one was to break Schiller, something these muscle-bound menaces actually seemed to enjoy.
In that warehouse, they just start torturing him. They're pistol whipping him across the face. They're taking his arm and burning it with lighters. They're threatening him. They're basically trying to intimidate him to make sure that he's going to comply with all of their requests.
They had Schiller blindfolded from the get-go with heavy tape that eventually caused sores on his eyes, very painful. He didn't eat for 3 days. He didn't have access to bathroom facilities for a long time. He soiled himself fairly early on and basically stayed soiled.
The next step in their plan was to force Schiller to make a series of outlandish phone calls to establish a cover story.
When he called his lawyer, he told the story of having fallen in love with a young woman and wanting to liquidate all of his assets so he could run away with her somewhere.
The first time Mark called me was on December 12th of 1994. He was leaving and he had a girlfriend. I don't think there was much more than that. It was kind of a brief call. It struck me with a core of unreality because he is not the guy that would take off like that. He's a very settled, family-type man.
A lot of these people didn't think that Mark Schiller sounded exactly like himself, but it is a little bit surprising nobody said, this just seems too weird and out of the blue.
Now that the gang knew no one was going to come looking for Schiller, they moved to step three of their plan. They forced Schiller to sign documents transferring all of his assets.
They made him sign many, many documents, including a change of beneficiary, quick claim deeds, and checks. There were two large checks written to a company called Sun Fitness. One was for $700,000, I believe the other was for $500,000. Mark was told to sign these documents while he was blindfolded, and his signature many times was perpendicular to the signature line or an inch or so above the signature line.
But lucky for the gang, Sun Gym owner John Meese was a legitimate accountant and a licensed notary. He was like the gang's chief financial officer.
John Meese's major involvement here was to notarize all those documents that Mark Schiller had been scribbling on blindfolded in the warehouse.
They took him basically for every penny he had.
After a horrific month of captivity, all of Schiller's assets had been successfully transferred over. His house, his cars, his life insurance policy, and over $1.2 million in cash.
It was obvious also that the gang knew Schiller was not going to be alive because the paper trail on all these documents was very, very clear. From the beginning, Schiller was doomed. He was going to die.
Now all that was left to do was to 86 Schiller once and for all. So they came up with an elaborate plan.
They forced him to drink an excessive amount of alcohol and gave him some drugs. And they staged an automobile accident. They doused him with gasoline and they lit it on fire. And then they went back to their vehicle to watch Mark Schiller die.
But they haven't buckled him in, and the flames revive him enough that unconsciously he opens the door of the car and stumbles out. And they see him right in front of them, alive and walking. And they yell, you know, run him over, run him over. And boom, they hit him with a car and run right over him, put it in reverse, they back over his body. And then they put it in drive, and they're going to drive over him a third time when they see headlights coming around the corner. So they spin out and take off in the other direction.
The Sun Gym gang certainly tried hard to kill Schiller, but this murder didn't work out exactly as they had planned.
My name is Marcelo Schiller. My friends call me Mark, and I'm alive.
At 4 a.m., an ambulance arrives at Jackson Memorial Hospital in Miami. A burned, battered man reeking of stale booze and rancid body odor is admitted as a John Doe. When he awakes, he faces a whole new ordeal.
First thing I did when I woke up was vomit. and it was blood, and I couldn't move. One of the doctors, a female doctor, came in, and she said, oh, he had a terrible car accident. I said, excuse me, you're wrong. I was kidnapped. Could you please call the police? She comes over and pats me on the head, like, you've been doing too much morphine, you know?
Now, you have to put it in perspective. This is a guy who's been in his same clothes for a month, relieving himself in the clothes. He's got wounds on his face. He's got a beard from not shaving. He's not clean. He's drunk. I mean, you can imagine that the nurse is just going to believe he's hallucinating. He's nonsensical. He's just a homeless drunk.
Despite his incredible luck, Marcelo Schiller knows the clock is ticking. Once the Sun Gym Gang finds out he's still alive, they'll find him and finish the job. And sure enough, Lugo, Dorbal, and Delgado were frantically calling hospitals to see if Schiller had survived.
Jackson Memorial Hospital says, yes, we do have a Marcelo Schiller. He's in intensive care. So they devise a plan. They're going to walk the halls of the intensive care looking for him. And when they find him, two of them are going to get into a fight to draw the police officer away. And the third guy is going to go into his room with a pillow and smother him.
I think my fate at that point was sealed pretty much. They were going to find me and finish the job. I got to the point where I was in panic. You know, because I can't walk out of there.
So Schiller calls the only person in Miami he knows he can trust, his attorney, Gene Rosen.
It was not your average phone call. He had told me, just in very general terms, about his being kidnapped. I didn't know exactly what kind of shape he was in, but did provide an answer to what was going on. I believed him, of course. Some people didn't, but I did. When I found out that we were dealing with questionable, unsavory characters, I called in Ed Dubois because of his background in the security business in order to help Mark out.
So I told Mark that he should get out of the hospital, go to a safe place. He said he had a sister in Staten Island, New York. This is the plan, get him out of the hospital, get him to a sister's, let him recover. The reason we didn't go to the police department the day that he regained consciousness was the fact that they would send a patrolman out in the hospital to interview Mark Schiller, either that day or the next day or the next week. And by that time, the guy would have been dead.
So they decide to airlift Schiller to a New York hospital where he'd be safer. When Schiller again tries to contact Miami police, they ask him to return to Miami to file a report. Still recovering, Schiller isn't too keen to return to the gang's stomping ground. His only hope now rests in private investigator Ed Dubois.
So Mark faxed me the documents, and I was, you know, shocked to find John Meese was a notary on some of the documents and a witness on some of the documents. I knew Johnny, and he had hired me on several occasions to conduct investigations, so he knew what I did. He respected me, and I respected him.
Dubois calls his old acquaintance and presses him for an explanation.
I told him the story, and I showed him the documents where he had notarized the signature of Schiller. And he said, you've got the wrong picture. This was all a business deal. And he said the two men that he did this for were Dan Lugo and George Delgado. And he believed they would have no problem meeting with me and explaining the whole Mark Schiller situation.
Dubois was still not sure how Meese fit in. But he'd gotten the names of two major players, Lugo and Delgado, and arranged for a meeting with them the next day.
I entered John Meese's office. John came out and said, Lugo and Delgado were late. Why don't you go to one of my other offices and you can sit in there and just relax and you won't have to sit in the reception room. We said, okay, fine. So he put us into a private office. On top of the desk, there was an ashtray full of cigarette butts and two wine glasses with the residue of wine. And it looked like somebody had been in that office the night before, drinking wine, smoking cigarettes. And now we see the garbage can is full of paper. Somebody was throwing away paper. In the trash can are checks where they spend Schiller's money. They're paying off their partners in this crime. You know, $20,000 to this guy, $50,000 to this guy. We had all of the financial documents that we needed to tie John Meese, Lugo, Dorbal, and Delgado to this crime.
Real smart. It's hard to imagine those goons making it any easier for the private eye to connect the dots. But with the bad guys just outside the office door, Du Bois would have to proceed with extreme caution.
I get papers stuck down the back of my pants. I know for sure that these guys, including John Meese, are involved in this crime. So eventually John Meese came into the office. So really, I took the lead, and I was very forceful, but not angry. And totally out of the blue, Johnny Meese puts his hands up, and he says, "Don't even go there, Ed. We're gonna give Mark Schiller his $1,260,000 back."
But this reimbursement had one big and very flawed catch.
Meese says, "There has to be an agreement that you and Schiller are going to be required to sign where you accept the $1,260,000 and never, never, never tell the police department." So I immediately think about that proposal, knowing that is an unenforceable contract. So I said, "That's no problem. We will do that."
These knuckleheads were actually negotiating with their former captive to return his money. But after weeks of back and forth BS, the money never shows up. 4 months after the kidnapping, it was time to take their case to the cops.
I've done work for the Miami-Dade Police Department for 25 years at that point as an outside contractor, and they knew me, so I figured I had some credibility. I gave the sergeant assigned to the case all the evidence, my report, all the background investigations that we had done, and he basically had the case with a bow around it on a silver platter.
But even with these damning documents, the case just sounded too outlandish. The kidnapping in broad daylight, the fiery crash, and Schiller somehow survives but doesn't go to the cops for months? As far as the cops were concerned, something about this case was off.
This was a pretty murky kind of case. There were clearly some very bad guys, but they weren't so sure about Schiller because he wasn't coming forward right away, and they were hearing this story so long afterward, I think they approached it with a lot of trepidation.
Ed Du Bois showed the police all the documents, the contract, and told him, "Go to the house if you don't believe it." And he goes, "This looks like it was just a car accident." I'm going, "What are you talking about, a car accident? These people are saying they stole my money. We have all these documents. To us, it's a car accident and a case of robbery."
I felt the gang were the baddest people I had ever come in contact with, and they're going to probably strike again. The response was, "Ed, I think you've been watching too much TV."
The police didn't even look at the money trail. They didn't look at anything. I don't know why. Their view was that this was such an outlandish story, and to think that I'm alive after all that, it's not possible.
The crime had been so implausible and so absurdly cruel that the cops just wouldn't buy it. That freed up Lugo, Dorball, and the rest of the Sun Jim gang to spend Schiller's stolen money.
They're very confident. You know, they're living in Schiller's house. They're driving his cars. They're wearing his jewelry. They took his furniture from his house and moved it into each of their apartments. They started going to strip joints with all of his money.
They bought electronics and sex toys and spent a fortune on clothes. They were having a great time on his money.
They were finally living the good life, la vida loca, as it were. But their greed was insatiable. So Lugo and Dorball decide to look for a new mark. This time, it wasn't the Sun Jim that would connect the dots. It was their favorite flesh palace, a swanky strip club called Solid Gold.
Noel Dorball sitting there with one of his stripper girlfriends. They're going through a photo album, and he sees this guy in a picture. And he says to her, "Who is this guy?" And she said, "Oh, that's my ex-boyfriend, Frank Griega. He's a really nice guy. He made all his money on 976 numbers. He's very wealthy." Immediately, the lights go on in that head of his, and he's thinking, this could be our next victim.
The Sun Jim gang had gotten away with the perfect crime. Well, a crime that was perfectly unbelievable. Flush with cash but hungry for more, the gang targets their next victim, millionaire Frank Griega.
Frank Griega's made a lot of money doing phone sex lines and drives a Lamborghini and has a home in Golden Beach, which is a very wealthy oceanfront community, and he looks to these guys like the perfect pigeon.
he was approached by these two people who acted like genuine businessmen and had a proposition which he was considering. Frank really had a very weird feeling about these two people. I think he was naive in a way. It was very hard for him to say no to people.
And the plan was, do the same thing you did with Schiller, take all their money, take their house, take their cars, take all their assets, and then get rid of them just like you tried to do with Schiller.
But unlike the Schiller kidnapping, Lugo and Dorbal were bold, or dare I say stupid enough to be seen meeting with Griga before they jumped him.
Lugo and Dorbal invited Griga and his girlfriend out to dinner. They invited them to a restaurant that they knew was going to be closed. It was across the street from Dorbal's apartment. So when they get to the restaurant and it's closed, they decide to go to Dorbal's apartment instead.
The gang had added a new play to their torture and extortion handbook. They would sedate the couple with, get this, horse tranquilizer, while forcing them to sign over their millions. But first, they'd have to separate the couple and immobilize them.
Noel Dorbal tells Frank, why don't you come back into my room? I can show you my computer setup. And Danny Lugo stays with Christina in the living room.
Hey, I gotta show you something. I like that. All right, come here.
But all of a sudden, they can hear just pounding on the walls, and there's clearly a scuffle in the bedroom. When he first grabbed him, Frank resisted, tried to break away. Christina screams. Danny Lugo immediately tackles her and injects her with horse tranquilizer. Unfortunately, in the struggle, Noel Dorbal kills Frank Griga.
Even though Griga was dead at that point, they still had his girlfriend, who, although drugged, was still alive. So they began to try to wake her up and get the security code for his house. She began to scream again. They shot her with more horse tranquilizer. They repeatedly tried over a period of hours to get the security code from her. And then eventually she died of too much horse tranquilizer. It was enough to kill several horses. What began as a kidnapping and extortion plot ended up in murder.
The gang realized they had to get rid of the victims quick. Their plan was to move the bodies to a warehouse to do their dirty work.
They took a trip to Home Depot to purchase some grisly items to dismember the bodies. They bought an axe, a chainsaw, some rags.
They try to basically cut Christina's head off, and the chainsaw gets tangled among the hair, and it just doesn't work. So they go return the chainsaw. They actually take their receipt and go back with the chainsaw so that the clerk at the Home Depot can remember them even more. So they end up doing all of their work with an axe. They chop off Frank and Christina's heads, hands, and feet because they want anything that could possibly identify them to be separated from the rest of the body. And they take a big knife and they pry their teeth out of their head to make sure that dental records can't identify them. And they go down Alligator Alley, and they take these big painter buckets with the body parts in it, and they toss them into these drainage ditches. They take the rest of the bodies, and they stuff them into oil barrels with some gravel or asphalt to weigh it down, and they seal them and dump them in drainage ditches in the south end of the county.
They disposed of the bodies. Now they just had to get rid of Griga's yellow Lamborghini.
The Lamborghini is found in a very remote area of the county, and that's really when police get involved. An abandoned Lamborghini probably means somebody disappeared not of their own free will.
Frank and Christina's friends start to talk about they were going to dinner with these bodybuilders. The names Lugo and Dorbal come up, and all of a sudden it's like a light switch comes on. A detective puts it together and goes, wait a minute, those are the guys that Marcelo Schiller told us kidnapped him. And all of a sudden, this whole house of cards falls apart.
Bodybuilders, kidnapping, missing persons. It was too much of a coincidence to be ignored. Finally, detectives take a fresh look at the Schiller case.
On June 1st, I received a telephone call from Major Al Harper. And he said, well, I just overheard a conversation in homicide about a missing couple somehow being connected to the Sun Gem. Thank God Al Harper recalled some of the details that I gave him 4 months ago.
Police quickly arranged to interview the one man who had felt the pain of the Sun Jim gang and survived.
I get a call from Metro Dade Police, and they say they've got a similar case. Would I be willing to come to Miami again and talk to them about my case? And I said, yeah, I'll come back and I'll talk to you.
The police had what they needed. They had all the evidence in the Schiller case. And it was like a blueprint for the Griega case.
The suspect used the same pattern as they did in the earlier abduction of the Argentine. It's possible that these two people are being held at a mini warehouse or a residence.
Desperate to find the couple before it's too late, cops race against the clock to search various gang members' homes.
They find an awful lot of Mark Schiller's stuff just lying around people's apartments. They'd cleaned out Mark Schiller's house thoroughly, and a lot of his personal effects, even things that weren't big ticket items, a lot of those wound up around their homes.
Once they do search Noel Dorval's apartment, they start finding evidence. They end up finding traces of blood using luminol. They're able to find traces of blood on the walls and on the floors, and it starts to really appear like a serious crime scene.
But with the killers still on the loose and the victims nowhere to be found, will police have enough evidence to shut down the Sun Jim gang once and for all? Miami police finally have enough evidence to make arrests in the Griega Furton disappearance, thanks to the evidence provided by Marcelo Schiller and Ed Dubois. Dorval, Delgado, and Lugo are found and hauled in.
Sir, you're charged with attempted first-degree murder, armed kidnapping, armed robbery, and burglary to a residence, and extortion.
Court finds probable cause, no bond.
Once in police custody, Lugo cooperates, but only so far. He gives up the location of the barrels containing some of the body parts.
What Danny Lugo did was he took him to the part of the county where he had dropped the torsos and not the identifying hands or face or feet.
And in the torso of the female are breast implants. And through checking the serial number and her medical history, they link those particular implants to her.
I came in the second week of June, and the two homicide detectives were waiting for me at the gate as I was coming out of the plane. And they told me that they found the bodies. So that was the end. Before that, when I boarded the plane, we were still hoping that he might be alive, but that was the end of it.
The Schiller kidnapping and the Griega Furton murder had all been part of the gang's gruesome business plan to make money by any means necessary. Finally, it was time for the Sun Jim gang to face justice.
When the case came to me, it had many defendants. Most of them pled out. Most of them entered into a plea agreement to testify as state's witnesses.
Prosecutors single out Delgado as the weakest link and the best state's witness. After all, it was Delgado whose murky business relationship with Schiller had sparked the first kidnapping and extortion scheme.
George was the glue that held a lot of this together. And they decided to go ahead and offer him the 15 years, which I think he readily took. And he became a very important witness to tie a lot of these events together.
Mr. Dubow had him in a headlock and twisting his neck and was killing him.
Prosecutors had to let one fish off the hook in the hopes that they could fry the bigger ones.
I ended up trying three individuals together, Daniel Lugo, Noel Dorval, and John Carl Meese. And they were the three most culpable of all the defendants. The indictment was so large, it took me an hour just to read the indictment to the jury.
I don't think I ever imagined that they were going to go to jail for what they were doing. They actually thought it, they could do it and just get away with it.
They slapped me, they hit me, they shocked me with a taser, baseball bat, butt of a gun.
After months of damning testimony and gory evidence, Lugo and Dorval finally face justice for the crimes they committed in the name of the seventh deadly sin, greed.
Guilty of first-degree murder. Guilty of first-degree murder.
Even Meese, the accountant who notarized the financial transfers, would be convicted of murder.
guilty of first-degree murder.
If Marcello Schiller was feeling any sense of satisfaction at that moment, it was to be very short-lived.
When I'm walking out of the court, I see three people behind me, and they tell me you're under arrest. At that point, I didn't even know what's going on.
It seems Delgado ratted out Schiller to the prosecutors. He told them that the Medicare billing business he bought from him was crooked. After all he'd been through, Schiller himself ended up serving 2 years in prison for fraud.
The government first ignored me because they couldn't believe anything, then used me because they needed me for the case, and when they didn't use me, needed me anymore, they disposed of me.
It was the final twist in a twisted tale of greed.
What they lacked in morals, they made up for in greed. Nothing seemed to be below them. Their North Star was acquiring money, and they just seemed to have no floor below which they wouldn't go to do it.
Human beings are capable of anything. There are people who, because of greed, they're willing to do whatever it takes for them to get their way.
Half my soul has been taken with him, and this is something nobody really understands. The pain is there, and it really will never go away.